Is the Lamb who Good morning. So, to be honest, I thought I was banished to the bullpen this week. Pastor Jeff's dad is not doing well. He had to take off yesterday and head up to Detroit to be with his family, to be with his dad, and what is most likely going to be his dad's last moments here on earth. But we can praise God even through that. His dad is a follower of Christ, so he has a hope that goes beyond this world. But sometimes those things are a struggle, right? Those things are hard. And we had that experience yesterday, even through Nathan's funeral, as we celebrated his life, and it was a beautiful celebration of the hope that goes beyond this world. And even through that hardship, even through that trial, going through the funeral and the presentation of the gospel, many professed Christ yesterday. So God is sovereign over these hard situations, and we can praise Him for that. So we'll pray here in a moment for both the Broich family, for Brittany, and also for Pastor Jeff. If you are visiting with us, we are really glad to have you. We do have a small gift for you and also some information on our church if you want to stop by the welcome desk after the service. If you came prepared to give, we don't take up a collection, but we have boxes out there that you can drop your offering in. And let's pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, Sovereign God, Holy God, we know that You control all things. And although we don't fully understand all that takes place, we can rejoice in knowing that You're in control. We can rejoice knowing that Nathan is with You. We can rejoice knowing that Pastor Jeff's dad is soon to be with You, that there will be suffering no more. That doesn't necessarily make the goodbyes any easier. There is a time for mourning. So we pray, Lord, we pray for comfort for these families, that they would know Your peace. That they would be able to rest in You in the weeks that follow, when it seems like everyone else's life is going back to normal and they're still walking through the grieving process. Give them the strength in those times, Lord. we pray for the service this morning. This is not what we had planned. This is not what Pastor Jeff and myself had planned. But these are your plans. You can take the ill-equipped and underprepared and use it for your glory and your purposes. So we pray, Lord, that we would have soft hearts to your word this morning. A desire to be doers of your word, to be obedient to you, not out of duty or obligation, but out of an overflow of our love for you, because you first loved us. We just love you and praise you, and it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. All right, so you can take your Ephesians notes. You can fold those up, and you can save those for next week. So I got the text message about 6 o'clock last night about preaching this morning. So I did not have enough time to prepare on what Ephesians chapter 1, getting into 3, 4 through 12, 13, 14, however far Pastor Jeff was going to go. There's some deep theological waters that's going to walk us through. So yeah, a couple hours of prep time. Not a good idea for that. So we are going to go to Galatians this morning. So I dug through the archives, and I'm going to preach a sermon that I used at the Logos conference back in November. So typically, I can't even remember what I taught on like a month ago. So I'm assuming if you were at that conference, you probably forgot what I said already. So I think we're good. It might even sound new to you. So we will be in Galatians, the book of Galatians, this morning. So Martin Luther said this about the book of Galatians. "The epistle to the Galatians is my epistle. To it, I am, as it were, in wedlock. It is my Catherine." So Catherine is the name of his wife. Why did Martin Luther say this? Why would he say something like that? That it is my Catherine. Because within the contents of Galatians, within the contents of it, in this epistle, one will discover the true gospel, the doctrine of grace through faith, which was Martin Luther's charge against the Catholic Church, right? It was his charge against the Catholic Church and its long-held belief in a works-based faith. I go back and forth on if it's appropriate or inappropriate to compare your wife to a book of the Bible. Not really necessarily feeling that, but that's what Martin Luther did. Luther's point is that there is nothing more beautiful. His point is that there is nothing more beautiful than understanding the true gospel. And that's what Galatians is about. It's what it reveals to us. So all Christ followers must hold fast to the true gospel. The gospel must be a non-negotiable. We can debate methods. We can debate stage lighting. We can debate chairs versus pews. We can debate music styles. We can debate VBS. We can debate how we support missionaries, on and on and on. We can debate whatever we want. There's a whole lot in this world that you and I do not have to agree upon. All right? Some people love to debate. They just look for things to debate, right? They intentionally seek out people who don't agree in an effort to set them straight and convince them of the right way, from politics to pineapple on pizza to whatever it might be. There is plenty in this world to debate about. But there are non-negotiables. And the biggest non-negotiable I can think of is the gospel. It is the gospel. We as believers in Christ, must not waver, we must not falter, we must not concede the true gospel. And we better learn to hold fast to it now, because coming is the day when somebody will attempt to rip it from your hands and declare it as hate speech. The day is coming. Holding fast to the Word of God is not this idea of just loosely holding on to something. Just loosely holding on to it. Holding fast is gripping it with everything that you have so nobody can rip it out of your hands. Nobody can take it from you. All right, so when I think of this, you know what comes to mind for me is, because I am one, I can say this, the Second Amendment rednecks who say, "You want my guns? Come and take them from me." That's where my mind goes. That's how we should be with the gospel, with the Word of God, with the truth that is in here, basically challenging anyone and everyone to come and take it. If you want my gospel, you're going to have to pry it from my hands, because I am going to hold fast to it. All Christ followers must hold fast to the true gospel. That's what Galatians is about, holding fast to the gospel. So if you're not there already, open up to Galatians chapter 1. We're going to start in verse 6, 1-6 through 10. There is no other gospel. "I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another one, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preached to you, let him be accursed. As we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one you received, let him be accursed. For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ." So a little bit of background to this. These churches are up against a lot. These churches, these Galatian area churches, they are facing persecution from other Jews. If we were to flip back to Acts 14:19, the Jews followed from some of the other areas like Antioch and Iconium and all these other areas and were persuading the crowds. They stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city as if he were dead. They thought he was dead. Now, these guys, these Jews, were probably pretty good at stoning people, and if they thought somebody was dead, he was probably really close to being dead. They drug him out as if he were dead. Paul hops back up, he goes back in, and he goes about his merry way. But we should not be deceived into thinking that just because Paul left that area and moved on to preach someone else, that the persecution from the Jews stopped just because Paul was gone. These churches faced that persecution from the other Jews. And then they were also facing Judaizers. Judaizers. So look at verse 7. "Not that there is another one, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ." Those are the Judaizers. What Paul is referring to in this verse is the Judaizers. They wanted to add to the scriptures. It is important to note that these churches consisted of both Jewish and Greek believers. These false teachers were teaching a grace plus something gospel. They wanted to add in, they wanted to mix in the Jewish beliefs of the day. That you had to be, it was grace, it was Christ plus circumcision. It was Christ plus ceremonial law. Grace plus, you better not touch that bacon. Grace plus social justice warrior. Grace plus, you better be voting Republican. Grace plus, you fill in the blank. It's grace plus nothing. And the sad part is, after being taught, after being discipled by Paul, these churches were caving to the pressure. They were falling for the false gospel. So notice Paul's tone and disappointment in verse 6. Verse 6 says, I am astonished. I am astonished that you were so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ, and are turning to a different gospel. They were falling for the false gospel. And his tone, Paul's tone, is a tone of disappointment. They weren't holding fast. So it's the old saying playing out. If you say something loud enough, if you say something long enough, people will begin to believe it. If you want to drive an agenda, just keep saying it. Just keep repeating it. And just keep getting louder. And Paul is not happy that they're falling for this. Suddenly the simplicity of the gospel had become too good to be true. It had become too good for the Galatian churches. We know what that's like, right? We have been taught, whether by parents or life circumstances, the school of hard knocks, that if we hear a deal that's too good to be true, it probably is. It probably is. So, for example, one of my kids not too long ago had the opportunity to learn this lesson. She picked up one of my hunting magazines, and she was flipping through it, and she came to a postcard advertising this beautiful Donald Trump collector edition train set. All over the advertisement, it says, "No money now, reserve yours free today." In her excitement, she pulls it out, she fills it out, and she places it in the mailbox. I'm grateful. I don't know if the Holy Spirit convicted her in this moment, but for some reason, she came back to me and told me what had happened. And immediately, as she's telling me this story, red flags are going off in my head. It's too good to be true. Ain't nobody gonna send you a free train. It's too good to be true. So she goes and she pulls that out of the mailbox, brings it back to me, and I start reading the fine print. Well, within the fine print, it says, you don't have to pay anything now, but once your order, payment not required until you receive the first part of your order, the Donald Trump engine, at which time a price of $69.99 will be due, and then $69.99 with each additional part of a collection totaling something ridiculous like $300 or $400. That's the fine print. So we learned a lesson that day about things being too good to be true. But the sad reality is we try and take the it's too good to be true mentality that we are forced to have in a sinful, deceitful culture, and we try and apply it to the gospel. We try and apply that it's too good to be true to the gospel. We try and say, it's too easy. Certainly it can't be true. Certainly I have to do something to earn my way. I have to serve enough. I have to put more money in the offering. I have to attend church this many times this week. Those things do not earn your salvation. Those things are not bad things. Attending church is a good thing. Giving to the kingdom of God is a good thing. Serving in the body is a good thing. But those things instead are to be done out of an overflow of our love for God. So we just talked about being faithful this last week. Faithful to Christ, faithful to the church, faithful to the body. And my niece, just last night, we were sitting down. My niece asked the question. I don't know where the question came from. They were not here last week. She asked the question, is it a sin to not come to church when the doors are open? Is it a sin to not come to church when the doors are open? My answer was, it is absolutely not a sin to not come to church when the doors are open, but that she is asking the wrong question. She's asking the wrong question. The question should be, what is going on in someone's heart that they would desire to not be with the body of Christ. What in their life has taken the place of God, and that's where the sin lies. There may be a good reason to not be here. There might be a good reason to not be here. But in evaluating the heart behind the why, that's where the sin lies. We are called not to some legalistic earn your salvation approach, but instead what we are called to have is a childlike faith that my daughter was showing in it with the train set, that trust in what is said is true. The trust that in what is said is true. The trust that in what is in the Word of God is true. That we are saved by grace. We are saved by grace, not by works, not things that we can do. And that's what the Galatian church was forgetting. And we are called to have that childlike faith. Matthew 18:3 says, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Luke 18:17, "Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it." Matthew 19:14, "But Jesus said, let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for to them such belongs the kingdom of heaven." So we must hold fast to the gospel of Christ. It is the only true hope. The only true hope. It is the only true power, and it is simply the way. The way. It is the only way. You can't earn it. So the gospel. Chapter 3 of Galatians opens with this statement. "O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you?" So let's read 3:1-9. "O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified. Let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish, having begun by the Spirit? Are you now being perfected by the flesh? Did you suffer so many things in vain? If indeed it was in vain, does he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you do so by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Just as Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now then, that it is those of the faith who are the sons of Abraham. And the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preach the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, in you shall all the nations be blessed. So then, those who are of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith." So this is this in the same vein. The theme running through Galatians is the same as all the way through. Same vein as chapter 1. This points specifically back to Christ. Chapter 1, verses 3 and 4 does the same. "In the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself up for our sins to deliver us from this present evil age, according to the will of God, of our God and Father, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen." The gospel is Christ crucified. Our salvation is by faith. The word gospel literally means the good news. The good news. It was a term used by a runner returning from battle to deliver the news of victory. Delivering the news of victory. So imagine you are hiding behind a wall. You're hiding behind a wall. Your army is off on some major battle defending your very lives. Defending your very lives. And off in the distance, you see a man running towards you. And the news that he is delivering is news of victory, that your lives have been spared, that you're not going to be carried off to be some slave somewhere else. So that's the news. When we use the term the gospel, the good news, that's how it was used back then. Do you think that was a time of sorrow? Like, oh, it's good news. The paper had good news this morning. We're not all going to die. We're not all going to be slaves. No, the good news should bring us great joy. The joy of victory that is done through Christ. Is done through Christ. Our victory is not found in the law. For all who, if you look at 3:10, for all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse, for it is written, cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them. He's telling them, if you don't want grace, if you want the law, if you want to live by the law, then you have to keep every single one. Every single one. One mistake and that's it. One mistake and that's it. He's telling them, don't turn back to the law. Don't turn back. It is by grace. And chapter 5, verse 1 states, for freedom Christ has set us free. For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. Why? Why? Why would the Galatians? Why do we look at the gospel? Why do we look at grace and say, it's too easy. Put me back in chains. I want to earn my way. You can't be good enough. Don't put yourself back in those chains. Don't submit again to the yoke of that slavery. So it's an interesting fact. As we work through this book, Paul is preaching the gospel to believers, right? The gospel is not something that we just throw off once we are saved. The gospel is something for us every day that we should be reminding ourselves of, the hope that we have, the grace that we have, the mercy that we have every single day. It's something that we must rejoice in. It is something we should never grow weary of hearing. You do not ever grow in your spiritual maturity beyond the foundational beliefs of the gospel. You don't grow beyond grace. The gospel is something for us every day. A loving heavenly Father provided a way for sinful men like you and me. So we're going to do a little audience participation. I love audience participation. I love getting out of the normal. So if you guys would all humor me and just stand up, if you are able, just stand up for a minute. So we are men and women who are completely depraved. Tammy, you can't leave. This is audience participation time. We are men and women who are completely depraved. All right? Listen to this. Listen to my words carefully. We lie. We cheat. We steal. We deceive. We lust. We blaspheme God. We commit idolatry. We commit murder in our hearts. We hate other people. God says that's murder in our hearts. We are gluttons. We Baptists try and justify that one a lot. Drunkards. We are addicts. We have unrighteous anger. We have quarrels, divisions, fights, jealousy, enmity, strife. And this is not an exhaustive list, right? I could keep going, but I have a feeling this will be good enough. So, if you have committed one of those sins, any one, just one. So this isn't like, oh, I was that way 10 years ago, but my self-help book that I just read and my 10-step program, whatever it might be, has gotten me out of that sin. No, if you have committed one sin, one of those sins on that list, go ahead and sit down. Well then. Yeah, right? There's no chair up here. I'm sorry. I'm sitting, I assure you. Y'all need to keep better company, right? We're all a bunch of sinners. We're all a bunch of depraved people. But look, we have unity in the body. We're all in agreement on one thing. Not one of us is left standing. Not one of us is better than the other. You don't know why the person next to you sat back down. You don't know what sin they're battling with or what they're dealing with or what they've wrestled through in their life. All we know is that transgression, going against God's law, condemned us. And we are all in the same boat, regardless of what that sin is. A holy God and our amazing Creator cannot tolerate sin. Sin is not in His nature, and sin must be punished. Sin must be punished. We often look at that and we say, why would a loving God do that? Why would a loving God do that? And we often try to blame shift a little bit. We try and say, it's God's fault. But the reality is, you chose to sin. You chose to sin. Just like Adam and Eve chose rebellion, we chose rebellion as well. We looked at that fruit in front of us, whatever worldly thing that you want to call that fruit, whatever it might be, whatever sinful desire, whatever lustful desire, whatever idolatrous desire that put you in that boat, whatever it was, that fruit that was in front of you, you took that fruit and it shackled us. We shackled ourselves and we became slaves to sin. But the God that we love to question and say, this is God's fault, our loving God provided a way, and only one way. Christ said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Not one of the ways. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Somebody might say, well, that's closed-minded. No, that's not closed-minded. That's truth. Truth cannot be anything but truth. It is only truth. Romans 5:8, one of my favorite passages, says this, but God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. All right, notice how that sentence starts out, that passage starts out. It starts out with a but God. It didn't go, not but when Jason got his act together, when he got it all figured out, when he got his life straightened out, God chose to redeem him. No, that's not when it was. It wasn't when I stopped failing or stopped sinning. It was when we were yet sinners. That is grace. That is grace. Grace and mercy. Grace is getting what we don't deserve. Salvation through Christ. And mercy is not getting what we do deserve. We deserve eternal punishment and damnation. Grace and mercy. Grace and mercy. So how about you, my friend? I'm not going to assume the gospel on you just because you are in church this morning. I'm not going to assume that you are under God's grace and mercy. Have you gotten this right? Have you gotten this right? Salvation is not of our own doing. You can't work hard enough or be good enough. That is utterly clear as we've worked through these passages. It is only by the work of Christ on the cross and his resurrecting power over death. He paid for those sins that we listed and that we talked about. Those condemning sins, he paid for them. But you must put your faith and trust in that fact. And through that comes repentance. Repentance is a turning from our rebellion. You are going one way against God. You are in rebellion against God. And he chose you out of that rebellion and said, no more. And turned you the other way and set you in a direction walking back towards him. Repentance, a surrendering of your life to him as Lord of your life. Have you done that? Have you done that? Have you truly done that? If not, now is the time. If anything has been made more clear over the past few weeks, it's that life is short and unpredictable. We are not guaranteed tomorrow. Now is the time. Right here, right now, in the middle of a message. So if y'all would just bow your heads for just a minute. Bow your heads, close your eyes. This is you that we're talking about today. You recognized your sin. You feel the weight of that sin. And you are feeling that pressure. And you want that assurance of salvation. You want that grace that we are talking about, that mercy. If you would just slip your hand up and we'll pray together. If that's you this morning, I don't care if you've attended church your entire life. That happens. All right, let's pray for a minute. Heavenly Father, we do pray that if there is any here today that is feeling the weight of that conviction, that you are working in their lives, but God, if they feel that, that they wouldn't push it down, that they wouldn't harden their heart to it, but today would be the day of their salvation. So I pray, Lord, that if there are any who are wrestling with that decision, that they would seek out somebody to talk to. That you would not let them rest until they get that taken care of. And we pray this through your Son. Amen. All right. No, we're not done. I know, right? Hi, Judy. I didn't even see you get up there. We're good. Surrender and serve. Surrender and serve. My last point. See, that's where I mess with people because I'm not a normal pastor. I know. Like, I'm very abnormal in the way I do things. Surrender and serve. My last point is surrender and serve. If we are clinging to the gospel, if we understand the gospel, how then do we live? We surrender and we serve. 1 Corinthians 6:19, 20 says this, "Do you not know that your bodies are temples," this is speaking to believers, "do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price." You were bought at a price. I love how Paul words it in Galatians 2:20. So if you're close to that, you can flip over to that. "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. In the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." What is he saying? He's saying it's not about me. It's not about us. It's not about our comfort. It's not about our own glory. It's not about advancing our own agendas. It's about surrendering our lives for the glory of God and serving for His kingdom and for His purposes. We should live in this world marked by the fruit of the Spirit. So you tell me which one you are marked by. Galatians 5, 16 through 21. When I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh, for the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. And things like these. The fruit of the flesh. The fruit of the flesh. Or are you marked by the fruit of the Spirit? Galatians 5, 22 through 26. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. It is joy, it is peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If you profess Christ, which are you marked by? Which list marks you? So as we wrap up, really this time, Judy, really, as we wrap up, all Christ followers must cling to the gospel. In this depraved world, we will face false teachers. They are out there. They are out there. We will face political agendas. Obviously, we will face persecution. We will face trials of various kinds. We will face hardships. We will face viruses. We will face deaths. We will face destruction. We will face depravity of all kinds. And through it all, we must cling to the Word of God. This is our hope. Cling to it. Proclaim it. We live it and we show it to a lost world, and we show what love truly is. True love in the shape of a cross. True love in a crown of thorns. True love in a God that provided a way. In our depravity, He provided a way. We change the world by clinging to and proclaiming the true gospel. The mission has not changed. Let's pray. Lord, we humbly come before You, and we are grateful for Your word. We are grateful for the salvation, the grace and mercy that we don't have to earn. That sounds too good to be true, but we know and we can believe and we can rest in that salvation. And we pray, Lord, that we would desire to be obedient to Your word, not out of obligation, not out of duty, but out of love. That we would know and understand that our Christian faith does not end when we walk out of these doors. That the mission is out there. And it feels like the mission field around us is growing more and more every day. Help us, Lord, to be bold in our faith, regardless of what this world becomes around us, regardless of the persecution we face. Help it to drive us further into the gospel, to cling harder to your word, to cling harder to the truth. We just love you, Lord, and we praise you and thank you, and it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand as we sing this closing song together?
Amen. I appreciate you guys. Love you guys more than you will probably ever fully understand. I will mention, I was extremely grateful as we worked through Nathan's funeral, how hard and diligent this body works and comes together to pull something like that off. The deaconesses, our sound people, just the hands that jump right in and make those things happen. So I appreciate you guys in that. My friend Amaya, accomplished something very amazing this weekend. So she traveled to Indiana, and she won, placed first, all around first, in the region. So when we think region in sports, we usually think the state, but she placed in gymnastics number one in the region of like, what, 5-6 different states? So strong work. We have some amazingly talented teens from music to gymnastics to other sports. Some of us are just Joey Breckles, but you know, I'm kidding. I love you, Joey. Joey's talented too. Joey's my go-to pick-on guy, so. Small groups tonight, If you're not in a small group and you're interested in a small group, talk to somebody. Youth group tonight, if you are in sixth grade, getting ready to move up, this is one of those nights that you can join us to get acquainted with guys like Joey and girls like Amaya. Amaya will do a backflip for you, I'm sure. And I think that's it. So we're done. See ya.